I'm going to talk about radioiodine depolarization for excision of lesions, particularly non-palpable breast lesions. Traditionally, we are using wires to excise non-palpable lesions surgically. And there are many lesions that we excise, typically, I mean, obviously malignancies, atypical ductal hyperplasia, globular neoplasia, complex fluorescing lesions or radial scars, papillary lesions, particularly the ones with atypia, fibroepithelial tumors, and phalloides tumors. In our practice, sometimes the patient or the surgeon requests skipping the corneal biopsy and going straight to an excision via wire localization. And also sometimes the patients have comorbidities or they're on anticoagulation and they cannot be stopped. We skip the corneal biopsy and move on to localization, which traditionally has been done with wires. Wires have their challenges, as we all know. They can get dislodged during a painting mammogram subsequent to their placement, during patient transfer or positioning in the operating room. They can migrate into the distal to the lesion into the breast. Sometimes they can end up in the axilla and occasionally in the mediastinum. They can also be cut or pinched, and ultimately the targeted lesion, the localization of it, can be lost. Patients also often don't like the process of placing a wire in their face. As we know, they can faint, they don't like walking around with the needle and with the wire, and sometimes they end up waiting for hours before they go into the OR. Additionally, as we know, it's very difficult to determine the margins, the microscopic margins of the specimen when you do wire localization. And subsequent to the excision, after the specimen is removed, it's very difficult to pinpoint the exact location of the lesion. Scheduling conflicts are very important. As you know, wires are placed the same day as surgery, and generally these patients cannot be the first patient going to the OR in our institution. This is an example of a complicated lumpectomy subsequent to wire localization. The targeted lesion had a ribbon clip in it, and this is a 2D mammogram showing the wire just next to the clip. The specimen radiograph, however, did not contain the clip, which, as we all know, happens all the time, and the surgeons will say, that's okay, I'll just wait for pathology, I think the clip fell out, or it's probably sucked out. And in this case, there was no cancer in the specimen. I have to say that this was done by one of our very, very skilled, subspecialized breast surgeons. And every once in a while, we see a case where it failed to get the targeted lesion. So the patient was sent for a post-lumpectomy mammogram, and as you can see, the clip is still in the breast. And the lumpectomy bed, which is demonstrated by the surgical clip, is much more superior than the target. So then we scheduled her for another wire localization, and this time it was successful. So there has been different alternatives to localization with wires over time developed. Sometimes the surgeons, depending on the institution they're in, can perform ultrasound-guided localization of lesions in the OR. This is somewhat challenging depending on the institution you're in because of turf battles with radiology. There's also issues with if a surgeon does the imaging in the OR, is it documented and saved in PACS, is it archived, who's responsible for interpretation? So this by itself can be very challenging. There's also radio-guided occult lesion localization, where the target lesion is injected with imaging guidance with technetium-99M MAA. And as we all know, technetium has a short half-life, and therefore it must be injected within 24 hours of the patient going into the OR. Which brings me to the topic of RSL, or radioactive seed localization, where we place seeds that contain radioactive iodine into the target. So a little background. First pilot study was published in 1999 with 25 subjects. And then subsequent, from 2000 to now, there was increased adoption of RSM programs in the U.S. Currently, just to name a few places, at Brigham we just started doing this, Memorial Sloan Kettering Mayo Clinic and University of Pittsburgh, just to name a few. Implementation, then followed research, which showed RSL was favorable with respect to margins, volume of tissue, ease of localization, and patient satisfaction. RSL has been shown to be at least as good as wire localization, depending on the study. Some studies suggest that it's better. It's better or equal in terms of technical ease of the procedure for both the radiologist and the surgeon, operative times, patient satisfaction, negative margin rate, reoperation rate, and allowing simultaneous axillary staging. A recent article from Netherlands reviewed six studies. About 1,600 patients was recently in 2013 was published in British Journal of Surgery, and they showed a complete tumor removal rate of about 90 to 97% based on the three largest studies they reviewed with more than 300 patients. In five of the studies, the reoperation rate was about 4.6 to 27%. Clinically relevant seat migration was extremely rare and less than 1%. And seat placement failure was observed initially but decreased over time. Another study, which was recently published, looked at more than 1,200 patients with more than 1,600 seats, and it was a 7-year study. The rate of initial complete resection of a single seat in lumpectomy patients for clinically appropriate cancer was about 85 for in situ and 81% for invasive tumors. There was a significant reduction in resection specimen volume for patients with non-palpable invasive tumors who had primary surgery and patients who had neoadjuvant chemotherapy. A 2014 study from University of Pittsburgh looked at 232 cases in 2011 and 12, and they looked at width of the closest surgical margin, re-excision rate, reoperation rate, ratios of tumor volume to initial surgical specimen volume, and tumor volume to all surgically excised volume. They also looked at cosmetic results and specimen volume in relation to the breast volume. They looked at radiology resource utilization before and after institution of RSL. And they found no significant differences between traditional wire localization and RSL across surgical outcomes they studied. They did, however, notice a significant improvement in use of scheduled interventional appointments, staff time, and patient wait times after the program was started. There was a 34% increase in scheduled biopsy slot utilization, 50% site savings in time spent scheduling, and a 4.1-day average decrease in biopsy wait times. So RSL has benefits across all the team members. For surgeons, it allows them to do a more accurate localization. It's very intuitive for most of them, particularly the ones who use technetium for sentinel node biopsies. It's basically the same procedure. Surgical planning can be based on best approach, not where the wire is going in or the tip ends up. Less volume of tissue is excised. The margins are, they have a lower rate of positive margins and increased OR efficiency and utilization. For patients, the best benefit is that it uncouples localization procedure and surgery. Seeds can be placed up to 5 days prior to surgery and enables the placement to be at the time of their pre-op visit. It's more convenient for patients. They don't have to be in PO, there's no wire in the breast, and the patient can go directly to the operating room. They don't need to arrive to radiology first for localization, and therefore they can be the first case of the day in the OR. The radiologists also benefit from this in that they can place the seat using best approach. They don't have to consider the surgical approach. They can also mix these patients with their regular biopsy or procedure schedule. And the technique is very easy. There is a very short learning curve, and it's basically similar to placing the wire or a clip. There are some radiation safety concerns, however. The seeds are considered safe for human exposure by the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, or the NRC, which oversees this whole process in the U.S. The radiation that's emitted from the body is very small, and it decreases significantly at a distance of 1 foot from the implant site, and basically there is no radiation reaching beyond 3 feet. People in very close contact may be exposed to very small doses of radiation, which obviously depends on the duration of contact. There is no harm by hugging, kissing, or shaking hands, and basically we instruct the patients to avoid placing an infant or a child or a small animal on their chest for more than 30 minutes daily until the seed is removed. The radioiodine seeds are 4.5 by 0.8 millimeters, and they contain 0.1 to 0.15 millicuries of radioiodine, iodine-125, which is impregnated on silver nitrate and housed in a titanium shell. The exposure, as we talked about, is very low. The half-life is 60 days. And the peak, the emission peak from iodine-125 is different than that on titanium. The peak for iodine-125 is 27 keV, and for technetium it's 140 keV. And the different peaks allow for different detections at each site. As you can see, the graphs show the peak of iodine at 27, and technetium, the higher peak at 140, and the half-lives obviously are different. So we can place seeds in the axilla for evaluation of nodes, particularly at the site of the positive node. And as we all know, it's very difficult to image the axilla mammographically, and therefore once we place a seed in the axilla, we always have to prove that or confirm the presence of the seed using our LiDAR cameras in radiology. And because of this, if a patient is to get injected with the Cadmium-99 for a sentinel node biopsy, we have to place the seed first. The disadvantage is that it's a very, very regulated system, and it requires a lot of training for everyone. It requires radiation safety officer, proper facility licensing, new protocols, and additional trained personnel to run a successful program. Employees carrying out the program, which includes surgeons, nurses, technicians, pathologists, radiologists, etc., they all must be trained in radiation safety. And trained personnel must oversee ordering, storage, transport, and disposal of the seeds. Protocols assigned to ensure proper seed handling and disposal and compliance with radiation safety and monitoring of RSL program are required. It's required that a radiation safety officer be present in-house, which kind of limits the smaller hospitals and institutions where they don't have a radiation safety officer. Improper seed placement is a major but a very uncommon concern. If a seed is not initially placed in a satisfactory position, we can remove or reposition it. Therefore, either a wire or a second seed must be placed, and then subsequently they both have to be removed at surgery. And as I said, NRC basically governs our RSL program. In addition to that, there are some state regulations which vary from state to state. Authorized users are basically radiologists who are, after certain hours of training, determined to be able to place the seed, and they have to write a written directive, which is basically a prescription for radioactive material. And again, the NRC oversees all of this. And they have determined that the seeds must come out between 5 to 7 days after placement. Basically, basically the radiation safety officer and the department, they need to provide documentation that meet the requirements for state licensure, including safety training, authorized user directive, and quality assurance issues. They need to provide training for all personnel who handle the seats. And they need to work with the radiation safety committee to establish institution standards and gain authorized user status for all radiologists. They also oversee the tracking database and seat accountability. So this is the life cycle of the seat in our institution. A seat is received in the radiopharmacy and is tested and entered into the RSL tracking database. Then they're transported into breast imaging suite and are stored in a locked box. When the patient arrives on the day that they're scheduled for seat placement, they receive the seat after a written directive by a radiologist is signed, and it's tracked. The seat is tracked by the radiologist in the database. When the patient presents on the day of their OR, again, the seat is entered into the database, and the removal is confirmed by the surgeon. Then the specimen is sent to pathology, and the seat is recovered. It's placed in a container, which is radiation safe, and then it's ready for pickup. Again, it's entered into the database. The seat is recovered by the radiation safety officer and is placed in the appropriate disposal site for decay. Basically, the seat is accounted for at all times. If the seat is lost, or it's unaccounted for, or it's cut in half during pathology, these are all grounds for termination of the program. Therefore, everybody must be diligent at every step of the way. This is an example of what the seat looks like as it comes in the package to us. And this is an outside of the package. The seat is stored in the needle, and the stylet is used to place it outside of the needle. The plastic rubber that you can see in the top corner is used for safety to make sure it doesn't get placed by mistake. Once you're ready, we take it out. These are images, ultrasound images, showing the target lesion within the circle and the needle coming in from the corner. Subsequent to actually visualizing the seat being deployed, we take the needle out, and then the patient gets a mammogram, which in this case you can see the clip, tiny little clip next to the longer cylindrical shaped seat. We have documented mammographically before we send the patient out. Here's another example of grouped calcifications which were not amenable to stereotactic biopsy, and this was just localization for excision. You can see two view mammography guided localization using the needle and then the seat identifying it mammographically before we let the patient go. This is in the operating room, you're showing the probe and the Geiger counter. There are obviously potential problems, which are really rare if everybody is trained and they know what to do. If a seat is lost during placement, we lock down the room and basically survey it using our Geiger counter. We also must handle all the needles with care because we don't want to damage them in case the seat is within the needle and not deployed. In order to make sure the seat doesn't migrate, after we place the needle in the breast, we turn the needle after placement, and then we pull back one or two cm, get a mammo image to make sure the seat is deployed before we take the needle out. And I talked about the plastic safety measure that we keep in place until we're ready to actually deploy the seat, then we take it out. And if we're always ready to place the wire in, if the seat is determined to be in a less than ideal position, and obviously we need to communicate with the surgeon if any of the mishaps occur. if a patient has a fluid collection, be it a hematoma or a seroma, we don't want to place the seat in it, either place it adjacent to it, or we may consider a wire in that particular patient because the seeds can migrate within the hematoma and it doesn't allow for optimal localization. Our limits of seeds in each breast at this point are 2. If a patient has more than 2 lesions that need to be localized, we may consider wires. Logistically, it's hard to do both wires and seeds because if the patient has to come to the department multiple times. So if it's multiple lesions, we just go for wires at this point. We can bracket lesions using seeds. However, there has to be at least 2 to 3 cm distance between the 2 targets, so the surgeons can actually discriminate between each source in the operating room. And pathology must be very cautious not to use a scalpel to cut the seed in half by mistake. And basically, we have new special grid plates. As you can see, they have numbers and letters on them that we use for localization, so the pathologists know exactly where the seed is located and they don't cut it by mistake. Also, one thing to consider is that just like marker clips are lost in surgery, seeds can get lost in suction, and therefore it's suggested that the surgeon places sock over the suction canister in order to intake the trap. In case the seed is sucked in, they can retrieve it. And also, the surgeons must remember to use the correct setting for iodine 125 in the OR for their camera probe. So in conclusion, radioactive seed placement has been shown to be at least as effective as wire localization for excision of non-palpable lesions. The data is favorable regarding patient safety, surgical margins, volume of tissue size, ease of localization, and patient satisfaction. And there are some programs that are being adopted at major institutions nationwide and can be successful. The benefits to the patients, surgeons, and radiologists with proper planning and. Thank you.